talk about web development, of course, in this Orchard Content Management framework. But this also means that we will explore areas of web development generally. We will explore areas of software development and C# programming generally. We will see some industry best practices. We will also briefly talk about how to work in a team on a software development project. Because as you may know, because it's in the syllabus of the course, you will have to provide a project work till the end of the semester. We will give you details about that, how to specifically provide the project work to us. But the aim of the subject is, till the end, you will be able to produce a real world web application, whether it's a website, a portal, or a web-based game, or something else. It can be anything you decide, but this should be the product of the course for you. And we will work on that together, that you will be able to reach that. So let's see, and we really hope that everybody will be able to take away something very useful, and then you will be able to use it in real world projects, because this is not something academic, this is very practical. It's only worth it if you can use it later on. So let's see what we'll talk about. First of all, what's this Orchard? And what's this ASP.NET, whatever? What will be the topic of the course now? This is the Orchard homepage. Orchard is a content management system, but we rather want to call it, or we rather like to call it, content management framework. Why? Because it's a content management system. That means it's a web application that you can use to quickly build websites and add content to these websites. It gives you many features, like the basic content management features. You can write pages, blog posts. It handles user management, it handles media management, all kinds of everyday tasks that you encounter when developing a website. So if you want to create a new website, building on top of a CMS is a good choice, because you have all kinds of features that you otherwise would have to develop yourself. On the other hand, Orchard is a framework, a web application framework, and it's very strong on this. Actually, now is the time that it becomes more mature from the user experience kind of perspective. Before that, it was more developer-oriented, or more friendly to developers. So it's a very nice framework, and a very nice web application framework written in C#. It builds on the .NET web stack, so it builds on the ASP.NET MVC framework, that in turn builds on the ASP.NET web framework. So that means if you know ASP.NET MVC, or at least the MVC paradigm, you can more or less quickly begin to develop for Orchard, because Orchard builds on ASP.NET MVC, so you could theoretically almost write pure MVC projects inside Orchard, but that wouldn't be much of a use, of course. So if you learn a bit more, you learn a bit what Orchard can provide on top of ASP.NET MVC, how it enriches ASP.NET MVC, you can achieve much more. During the course, we will see how Orchard works from a user's perspective. So we will see how to do the basic content management tasks. And then, from the third, fourth lesson, we will start developing for Orchard. So we will write code in Visual Studio that will be C# or Razor. As you may know, Razor is the almost C# template language that's quite coupled with ASP.NET MVC projects. It's very popular templating language in ASP.NET MVC projects, and Orchard also uses it. So we will develop with these tools. So what do we have to do if we want to get to know Orchard? First of for, here's the Orchard homepage, orchardproject.net is the URL. This is this is really the hub of everything that happens around Orchard. Of course, this is just a website, so we won't get to learn it, but just so you know, here it is. It's worth noting that that the latest news all around the Orchard ecosystem, including third-party blog posts, are listed on the front page. Here you see blog posts from everybody who is involved in Orchard, and also the latest podcasts, because there are weekly community meetings, and these are recorded. Because Orchard is a community-driven and open-source project. Now, what does this mean? It's community-driven. That means that basically every decision is made by the community. There is no company behind Orchard pushing it forward into that direction. If you are a community member, and everybody is a community member who uses Orchard and wants to contribute to it, wants to let their voice heard, if you are a community member, you can vote on things. You can push the project into a direction you would like to see it go. You can propose features, you can file bug reports, whatever, because it's community driven, you decide. And it's also open source, so that means you can see the full source code of Orchard. You can modify it, you can go through it and learn through it, because it's very useful if you if you see a big project, a big, well done project that has quality code, and you go through it, you can learn a lot. Orchard is very good for this, for learning how to do software development well. And it's of course free, so it's open source. You have the source, you can do whatever you want. There is no commercial license, you don't have to buy anything. Now, this is the project homepage, but probably more interesting or something you would like to see more is the CodePlex site. It's reachable from here. So here is the Orchard CodePlex website. This is the central hub of the development side of Orchard. So this is, if you may know, CodePlex is something like GitHub or Bitbucket. So there are code repositories and little communities around projects. So on the Orchard website, Orchard CodePlex site, we have some notable things. First of all, discussions. If you have any questions regarding Orchard, ask it here. The whole community is here and they may help you. If you have questions that you want to ask during this course, you can ask them here too. So please ask them here, don't ask them as directly. But prefix your threads if you open a discussion with Dojo Course. So we will keep an eye on those discussions and we will chime in as soon as possible. So please ask questions here. If you have found any bug, any issue with Orchard, go to issues and file a new report, a new issue report. So if you create a new issue, okay, I have to log in, whatever. Here is, for example, another issue. An issue report is either a bug report, so something is not working in Orchard, or a feature request, for example. So again, Orchard is community driven. If you want to have something, open an issue about it, and it will be evaluated, and probably somebody will also implement it. But you too can implement it, since it's open source. So it's not like commercial software. It's very open, and it very much depends on the community. If you are a developer, you have to use the source code of Orchard. Because as a developer, you want to have you want to have access to the source code. You want to go through the source code and really see what the project is about. Now, go to the source code and download it. This is the latest source, but if you want to download the latest release source, just go to downloads and download the Orchard source. You could also there are also community sites, by the way. And so if we go back to the Orchard app side, you can see that that there are local communities. So there is even a Hungarian website. But that said, let's go to try out Orchard. So how it works, what's the ins and outs as a user, what do you have to know as a user about Orchard? Because that's just what's around it. But we haven't used Orchard yet. Now, unfortunately, we have some technical difficulties in this room. So only this lesson, you won't be able to try this on your student machines. If you have a laptop here, you can do the same because you can there you can install things, install software. But here you don't have administrator account, so you won't be able to install anything. So sorry about that. We will just demonstrate everything for now. But coming to the next lesson, you will have Visual Studio 2012 on your machines, and everything will work. What we will use now is WebMatrix. WebMatrix is a neat little software. Let me go to the front page, yes. Now, WebMatrix is a small web development tool. We won't bother much with WebMatrix because we will use Visual Studio and the hardcore development tools. But for this lesson, we will take a look at WebMatrix. We will install Orchard with WebMatrix because it's very easy to install it through WebMatrix. And we will run it from here. So if you would like to just show somebody Orchard or just very quickly try it out, install WebMatrix, it's free. Just search for it on the internet, you can download it. And once you have it here, you can install Orchard from the gallery. Like following, click new. We have an app gallery. Orchard is an application that's accessible from WebMatrix. You can see there are many applications, including other CMSs, but we will use Orchard CMS now, of course. Let's call the site Dojo Course demo site. And if we click next, yeah, we know what Orchard CMS is about, so next again. We accept the terms, of course. And Orchard will be downloaded and installed here. So we don't have to install any server. We don't even need Visual Studio on this machine. It is installed, but we don't need it. We can just run Orchard from this WebMatrix. All right, okay, it was successful. And it also starts the site at once. So back to WebMatrix, we have this a little control panel once we have installed Orchard. Nothing really special here or nothing really interesting because it's quite simple here and we really won't bother much with WebMatrix. One thing to note here is the database tab or menu that isn't showing the the database of the demo site. Because it's not yet there. We don't have a database because first we need to install Orchard, so let's do that first. Our site has already started. It automatically starts if you install it through WebMatrix. And this is the first screen you will see when starting Orchard. Anybody has installed any CMSs, whether it was PHP or anything else? Well, yes, what was it? With CMS? It was Orchard. Okay, so you are already familiar with the screen.
And
Joomla. Yeah, I don't have a Joomla, but there are some other CMSs that have a very similar install screen, very simple, so really nothing to tell. Well, first we have to spell out the name of the site, so that will be Dojo Course demo site again. Username is admin, password is password, because we want to live on the edge. And this is something now more interesting. Orchard's data storage is abstracted, so you will never interact as a developer. You will never interact with SQL directly, because there's an SQL database behind Orchard. I almost say naturally, but now it's not natural anymore to have a database only as SQL, because we have many NoSQL alternatives, of course. But Orchard uses SQL. There is an SQL server in the background, but it's abstracted away. It uses, by the way, the anhibernate object relational mapping layer, but we won't interact with that either. So it's again abstracted away. But interesting now, however, that we can choose from multiple database providers. So Orchard can you also use SQL Compact, so that's the first option we have here. SQL Server Compact is just a database file. So the whole database will be stored in a single file inside the Orchard folder. And that's it. It's very lightweight, it's very simple. If you want to move your Orchard source away, because I don't know, you want to move it to another computer, you can just copy the folder because it includes the SQL Server database as well. It's very simple, but it's mostly meant for development purposes and very small traffic websites. If your website is more than just a few pages, due to performance reasons, it's advised to use a full-blown SQL Server version. But SQL Server Compact works well. Yeah. So for now, we will use it. But you can use a full SQL Server, of course. For that, you will need a connection string. Or you can use MySQL. It's also supported now. Probably in the future we will have more providers, but for now that's kind of enough. So we will use SQL Server Compact. And the next question is to choose a recipe. Now, what is a recipe? You can see there are three options. We can choose default blob or core. This is extensible, so what we see here is just the default, what's in the default package. A recipe is basically a state of the Orchard website. It's an exported version of what an Orchard website contains. It can contain settings, any kind of configurational data, and content. So, more or less, you can export an Orchard website into an XML file, and then from that, initialize a new website, and it will contain the same configuration, the same content. These recipes here don't really contain content, just the default one contains some example content, but it's more for configuration purposes. So if you choose default, you will have a default website with some test content. So let's choose default and continue with the setup. It's cooking the Orchard recipe. It will take a few seconds, but after that we will see how an Orchard website looks. Now it's in the background, it's creating the database. I think it's also doing some compiling probably, but I'm not sure about that, but definitely it's creating the database, and it initializes the site from the default recipe. So it's here. That's what you see after running the demo recipe. the Team Machine theme. So that's what we see here. The theme is how the website is skinned. So we will talk about themes and other kinds of extensions that you can use to extend the functionality of Watcher later on. Themes are, yeah, how you skin your website. And the default one is the Theme Machine. And it also comes with this Powered by Watcher signing. It's very funny because by just googling this string here, this text here, you can get a very crude approximation of how many Watcher sites are there. Because this is, most of the time, this is left here. So let's do something with this. First of all, we are logged in, so we use admin as a username and password as a password, but if we click here, we can change the password. So that's probably the first thing you would like to do if you have your password as password, because that's not very secure. We can sign out, of course, but what's more interesting is the dashboard. By default, here's the dashboard link. The dashboard is the admin area of Watcher. So we call it dashboard, but it's the admin side. So this is the backend. What we can see here is the environment where you can modify everything that's on the site. There are a lot of things, a lot of menu items, a lot of widgets here, well, almost widgets, a lot of text, so it looks a bit too much, I guess, at once, but we will get used to it. First of all, our website now has the name Dojo Course demo website. Let's go inside settings and change that because that's not very catchy. Let's call it just Dojo Course site, so not without demo. How we do that? You can freely explore these menu items here. We will take a look at some of them, but probably the most important one is the settings. The settings here. It also has sub items, but if you just click on settings, you will go to the general settings of the site. Nothing really complicated here. But we have here the site name. So if we change that, just go to your course site and click save here. Now our site's name is changed. Oh, wonderful. Everything works. At least this works. We have some other configuration options here. Take your time to just quickly discover them, but most of them are quite simple. I would like to know this site culture here. As you can see, by default is the US culture. Orchard is localizable. That means that you can have the same site with different with content of different languages. We could set up here HU, so the Hungarian culture, for example. We could install the localization package for the Hungarian language, and then everything would be Hungarian here. We will also see that. The time zone is also configurable. Yeah, page title separator, super user. These are quite self-explanatory, but the super user is the ultimate. Admin user, of course. These are just the basic settings, but probably the first thing you would like to explore in the backend. Anybody with any questions till now? It was quite basic, I know, but this was probably the first part. Nothing. All right, great. Then I think we could go on, but probably after a short break. Yeah, because we'll dive into content management, into basic content management tasks, and we would like to explore what really makes Orchard very flexible, and that's the content model. We will explore that next, after the break. So we will have a short 5-minute break now. Please. blog posts, how to deal with users, and probably widgets as well.
All right, so let's continue with some basic content management and how the user management and the dashboard works. Let's talk about first, what is the Orchard content model? Why is it a content management system? And why is it, of course, a development framework? But that's a later topic. So now we look into the content management. So basically, everything is around content in Orchard. This means that you can edit the already existing content types, which is a terminology here. So you can edit the already existing content types and create new ones. So basically, content type is a blueprint for your data. You can define what kind of data you would like to store in one piece, but you can break it down to smaller parts. That is called very simply content parts. So content part is a smaller set of functionalities where you can store, for example, very simple data from integers to pictures. So it can be very simple, it can be very complex. You decide, you can define what kind of blueprint you want to store. Also, another terminology here is sort of a smaller atom in this system is the content field. So content field is really much more simpler. Basically, it breaks down to integers, strings, drop-down lists, media items, and things like that. And you can organize these fields into parts, and you can select these parts and add them to different content types. So you can create a tree of the data you want to store and put it into different little pieces and put them together. You can reuse them anytime you want. So this means that when you define a content part, which stores a specific set of features, set of data, you can reuse them for different content types. So basically, when we see in the development part, everything is about extensibility and reusability in Orchard. So if you have a piece of code, you don't have to recode it and to use it again. You can always use the existing features, existing parts. So basically, that's what's great about Orchard, that if you have done something or someone else did something very useful, then you can reuse it again anytime. Let's see how this works. We have a menu item here called content definition. So we have two menu items here. It's called the local navigation. We have content types and content parts. So these are the default content types in the system. We have from very simple ones like a comment to little more difficult ones like the projection widget. We'll discuss these later on. So, and if you go to content part, these are smaller set of functionalities, but you may notice that most of the content parts have very similar or the same names as content types. So this is not a coincidence, because the default content types in the system have a certain functionality, and the content part that basically defines this functionality has the same name as the content type. But if you want to extend this content type, for example, you want to attach music videos to every page in the system, you can do that. But the default content part for that specific type is just the default set of functionality. And of course, we have also content fields too. So basically, the most useful demo is to create a new content type and see how it works. Let's say, and I think it's a new feature, and I hope this is already integrated into this version, but if I search on a content type, less for, I don't know, Dojo, then I will see that there is no result for that. But if I click create type, no, it's not integrated. Anyway, I can type Dojo here, and this will create a new content type called Dojo. And this is the list of the available content parts in the system, but of course, you can write your own modules that will define new content parts, or you can download any of the existing modules that have any content parts in them, and you can reuse those, of course. title part, which is basically just a string, a title. I'm going to select these. So, I didn't select body. Anyway, I'm just going to store a title here. So, as you notice, there is one here I didn't select. It's a common part, and as its name says, it's storing common data, for example, who is the user who created the content item, what was the creation date, and things like that. And it has some settings, but these are self-explanatory, so I won't go in them. For a content type, I can also add fields, not just parts. So let's see, these are the existing fields in the system. For example, I can store a boolean, which will be represented by a checkbox. I can have a content picker field, which will add a functionality with what I can select another content item and create relationships between content items. And I don't think I made this clear, but basically a content item is an instantiated content type. So I have the types, the parts, and the fields, and when I instantiate a content type, it will be a content item. And like I said, as opposed to, for example, WordPress, where you have already defined set of content types and you cannot really modify them, these are all extensible and editable. So let's just leave it with that. Basically, the content type editor is very simple and self-explanatory. So I'm not going to save that because we don't really need this one. The next thing about content types and content items is a terminology called versioning, which will mean that there's a specific setting for the content types, and let's see page because that's the simplest example. So if you go to content type editor, you see there's a setting here called creatable and draftable. Now creatable is basically an administration page feature. This will mean that this content type will appear here under the new items. So I just click on that and that will, I can create a new content item immediately of that type. Draftable means, as the description says, that this content type supports draft versions. This means that I can save a content item, but I don't necessarily want to publish it immediately, but basically it's a default feature for every content item, but I can create different versions of it. This means that I have a page, I had created it already, I can save it and publish it, so let's do that, because that's the demo is most convenient here. So I'm going to create a test page. I'm going to set as homepage just to see that it's created, and I'm going to publish it. So if I go to the homepage, I'm going to see that my page became the homepage. This is a simple setting, and the content is here. So if I go back to the dashboard, I can edit the already existing content items under content. Now if I go to edit, I can add other content here, for example, we are testing in production. So basically this is a change I don't want to expose immediately to the outside, but I can save it. So if I don't click publish now, only save, this will mean that if I open the homepage, the previous content will still be displayed. So versioning means that there are basically two different versions in the system of this page. One of them is published and is displayed. The other one is already saved, but I don't necessarily want to display it immediately. And as you can see, there are other options here. Under preview, I can see the latest version, which already shows the modifications I made. And I can of course show. I can click on publish draft, which means that the latest draft version will be published. And if I publish it, I'm going to go back to the home page and we'll see that the text has appeared here. Okay, so basically that's about will just disappear. And but these data won't be deleted from the database. So this means that delete is really a soft delete rather. So they can be restored actually, but due to some requirements, these items are not deleted permanently. So actually they remain in the system, but you won't see them on the admin page. So basically that's about content. Feel free to explore it, or really I encourage you to explore it, because these are very basic functionalities in the system, and since everything is really related to content in Orchard, more or less, every time you develop something with Orchard, you develop your own module, they will, well, in 90% will be connected to some content management tool. So, for example, you will create content items and skin some editors for your customers, for example. Okay, other interesting things here. There are basic content types, as I said, in the system that you can fiddle with. There are blogs, comments, taxonomies, which are for categories. They are really simple features and self-explanatory editors, so just explore them in private. Due to the lack of time, I'm not going to go into details with them, but they are really easy to use. So the next thing about customizing your own website is downloading, or actually writing, which we are going to later, but you can also download other modules from the gallery. There is one central gallery related to Orchard. This is the Orchard gallery. So this is reachable at gallery.orchardproject.net. So this is, we are near 5 million downloads here. That's cool. So this is part of the Orchard ecosystem. Basically every module that is available, well, most of them are available on the gallery. So you can create your own packages from your source code and upload it here. So the users will be able to see it. Another cool feature is that the gallery itself is a module. So you can have your own Orchard installation with your own gallery. So let's say you have some private modules at your company, for example, you can create a private gallery for the employees of the company. And they can see it and download modules from this. So we have two main categories here. One of them is modules, the other one is themes. So basically module is a set of functionality you want to code. Theme is really the skin or the look and feel of your website. And of course the handling of modules and themes is a basic feature and they are enabled by default. So let's see how they work. So if you go to the modules menu item, you will see this nice list, and you can see here the already enabled, the already available features in the system. Some of them are disabled, some of them are enabled. Now, why am I talking about features and not modules? Because this is the modules menu. So basically a module is a whole bunch of functionalities and you can break those down into separate features. So let's say I want to develop something really big into one module, but I can separate different functionalities into different features, and I can disable and enable them separately. And this is a very, very useful thing, of course. Under the install menu item, I can see the actual modules installed, and you can run recipes from modules. So basically one developer tool in Orchard is that you can define recipes in your modules. So let's say you want to create some test data for your module that you can start with. You can create a recipe inside your module, and then you can execute this recipe. So when you install the module, you can have some basic starting content. And of course, if you go to gallery, you can install modules directly from Orchard. So one way is that you, for example, search for some module, and then you can download the package and copy it into your Orchard folder. The other more simple solution is that you search for a module. Let's say, let's see, Google, yeah, just Google. I think Google Analytics will appear here, yes. So what you can do here is search for a module, basically just get the package, it's the same as if you did it on the website. If you click on install, and hopefully this will work with administration privileges included, this module will be downloading and installed here. So I don't need to do anything else with it other than just enable it if I want to. And yes, of course I want to enable this module. So what I did here is that I visited the modules menu and installed the module from the gallery. As we discussed earlier, Orchard is hosted on GoPlex, so basically you can have your source code hosted somewhere, and if you are developing a custom solution, it's a much more complex thing how you manage your modules. But if you want to make it easier for regular users to download it, you should of course upload your module to the gallery so they can be installed easily. And that's about modules. Let's see what we have under themes. So if I visit the themes menu, we have a little bit similar thing here. It works in a very similar way, so I can see what themes are installed already, and of course I can access the gallery. This time I'm going to be able to browse the themes, not the module. And another notable thing is that as you can see, if you visit the modules, you can see that some of these has some dependencies. We're going to these in detail later when we are developing actual modules, but a notable thing is that themes and modules can have dependencies, which means if you write a module or a feature that uses some other functionalities from a different module, you can define a dependency. So they will be automatically enabled if they are available. So that's about themes and modules. Let's see some more serious stuff about the dashboard and the administration functionalities of Orchard. We're going to see how users work. We can assign roles for these users. We can create and of course edit existing roles. So let's see how that works. If you go to the users menu here, you'll see that we have two local navigation tabs here. One of them is users, the other one is roles. So because the installation requires one user to be created, well, that's basically a normal thing for any system. We have an administration user here. So if I'm going to, if I go to the edit, you'll see that the admin user is actually not an administrator. Now this is an interesting thing, because the first user that is created in the system is a special user. This is called a super user, and as you can see, the admin, the only user here in the system, is a super user, which means that he's basically the god in the system. He can do everything, he or she can do everything. This can be changed, of course, so that's why this user doesn't need any specific roles, because the admin user is a super user. A notable feature here, of course, is I can create users here. So those users that have the access rights to create other users can do this and assign all the available roles to them. But if you, let's say, disable the users module, which you can do, but technically it would be possible if you, for example, delete it, this users submenu item under settings would disappear. So this means that if you have your own module, you can define your own settings for it, and that's another useful thing, all about extensibility, of course. So as you can see, if you visit the user settings, the checkbox for creating new accounts is disabled. Of course, it's a very simple thing, you can just enable it if you want. Let's go back to users. So let's say, I would rather enable it. So I will enable users to register on the site. So I'm going to do a quick demo with it. If I go to sign in, this text is going to appear here: register if you don't have an account. If I disable user registration, it won't be displayed. Dojo, and as you can see, dashboard link is not present here. Why is that? Because it's just a regular user with the authenticated role, which means he or she can log in, but that's all. He can access the content and things like that. If I sign in back with administrator, is it password? Okay, I just made a typo. Okay, so if I go back to dashboard, I can see that under users I have a new user here. Well, it's what we expected actually. If I go to edit, I can assign different roles to this user. So let's say this user is an administrator too. If I save and log out and back in, I'm going to see the dashboard is present here. So this will mean that this user has very similar privileges as the admin user, almost everything, but not a super user, but an administrator. So basically from now on I can edit this setting. So let's see what we can do about different roles. So these are the default roles in the system. As you can see, there are 7 of these by default, but I could only apply 5 of them to different users. Well, this is because they are special. One of them is authenticated. It really self-explanatory. If I'm logged in, I'm an authenticated user. Anonymous is another special role in the system. This is for not authenticated users. So let's see. Let's say anonymous user can access the site content by default. This means that if I'm not logged in, I can see the pages, blogs, things like that. As you can see, these permissions are breakdown into features. Now, this means that for your modules and the features in them, you can decide what type of functionalities the users in that role can reach. So, for example, this is a very silly thing, so never you shouldn't do this ever in production. But I could say anonymous users can apply a theme. Now, this is very strange, but this would mean that every user that hasn't even logged in can change the theme in the system. Now, this is very dangerous, but that's a possibility. So, as you can see, access site front end is allowed for unauthenticated users. This means that he or she can see the pages. So if I uncheck this and save, this will mean that if I access this page, of course I'm logged in, and even Dojo user is an administrator, so I can do everything with it. But if I sign out, I won't be able to access anything on this site, only the logon page. Now, this means that since unauthenticated users cannot access the site front end and, well, nothing else. Nothing else either. I have to log in to be able to see the pages. So I'm just going to log back in. So this is a very useful feature for managing your users and roles, and this means that you can provide a set of functionalities and predefined rules for your website without coding anything. So a lot of things has been done before us and coded before us, so we have a great set of features to use without coding anything. So regular users, non-technical persons can use Orchard as well for administration tasks. But let's sum up what we have done here. We have visited the dashboard, and we looked into the content management part of the system. We looked into the software development and web development framework part of the system later on. So basically, content is the most central thing in Orchard. There are a great set of content types defined in the system. You can edit these, create your own, do basically anything with them if you're an administrator using in that system, of course. Content types are a blueprint of your functionalities and data you want to code a little bit. If you're on the administration page and you are not a technical person, you are of course limited in these functionalities, but Orchard offers very useful things for non-technical person, people too. So content parse is a subset of features, and of course they are a little bit smaller parts in the system. They are for content fields, so they are really just basic data, and well, they can be a little more complex than, for example, an integer or a boolean, but they are the smallest part in the system. So you can break down your content into parts and then fields, and you can create your own content type. If you instantiate, for example, a content type, this will be a content item, and you can do different things with it, edit, display, and create drafts with it. So like I said, the versioning means that you can save different versions of the same content item in the system. You can decide which one to be displayed, for example, for the user. And you can also delete these items, but it's notable that this delete functionality is really a soft delete, so the data itself will be remaining in the system. Well, there's a good reason for that. It's data consistency. So let's say you have your data in different places in the database. So if you want to delete a content item, you may need this content item later on with other content items. If you have, for example, relationships between content items. Of course, this would be broken if you delete it or annihilate it completely from the database. So that's why deleting is rather a soft delete. Okay. So as I like I said, if you download the web or source package, you have a great deal of modules already present, and most of them are just basic features, like for example blogging, writing, creating pages, writing comments for these pages or blog posts and things like that. But there are other more complex features which we'll look into later on. These are, for example, the navigation, the workflows, and the projections and queries and things like that. So they are other more complex features. They usually require a little more knowledge of Orchard, but they are easy to use as well. So you can create content items, you can version them and soft delete them. If you want to extend your system, you can create your own modules, which we'll do later in the semester, but you can also download modules from the gallery. You can also download themes from the gallery, so you can customize the look and feel of your website and also add or remove functionalities from it. So that's another useful feature in the Orchard gallery. And of course, we have users, roles, and permissions, which is a very basic thing for a content management system. So you can assign roles to the users, you can assign permissions to the roles, and you can edit these permissions to be able to control what users can reach and what they cannot do. Any questions about these features? Anything that is not clear? Okay, it seems to me that it's all right.
So what we have seen now was really basic content management and basic site management. We will now go into a bit more detailed versions. More specifically, what we will do now is we will edit widgets. So if we go back to the front end, we can see this here. As Benedek has explained, this is our page here. But normally, content items are meant to, or just general content items are meant to well, be on a whole page. So the whole page is a content item. If you want to view a page like this here, you open it and it's there, and nothing else that really matters is on the same HTML side, but just that page. displayed on every page. And these are widgets. So what we have here, as I mentioned earlier, these are widgets. So widgets are, again, content items. So almost everything that you interact with from the admin side is a content item in Orchard. Widgets are content items as well. Now, why is this good? That everything is content item, because content items are very flexible, as Benedek has explained. So we can reuse pieces of functionality. We can reuse the same pieces of functionality for pages, for example, and widgets. So let's see what these widgets do here, and how what they have in common with pages, for example. So let's see where these are. We go back to the admin side, and you see here that we have the widgets menu item. This looks a bit complicated now, because we will have to get to know also some other notions here, some other terminology, but first not bother with anything else here. But let's go down to first leader aside. Now, this is the same here. So you can see here's the title, first leader aside. That's the same here. So this should be this widget. If we go to its editor, we can see something similar that we have seen with the page. So again, it's an editor. Now, before we dive into the details, what everything here means, I would like you to notice something. We have the body here. So this here is the body text. This is a rich text box. In the end, it's HTML. And it's the body text. If we create a new page, or edit a page, or anyway, if we open the editor of the page, we have the same body here. So this here, this rich text box, is the body. And this here in the on the widgets editor is the same body. So we have a piece of functionality, a piece of content, the body text, that's common. Now, how is it achieved? Let's go back just to rehearse it again, because it's the core of Orchard, so it's crucial that you get to know it. If we go back to content definitions, and we take a look at page, we see the body here, it's under parts, so we have the body part attached to the page content type. So as Benedek has explained, the content type is the page, and we have the body part attached. And if we search for widget, there are a few content types of widget, as you can see, but what we have seen before happens to be an HTML widget. If we click on that and see its content type editor, we have the same body here. So why is this great? This is great because you can write a single piece of functionality, like the body. You can write its editor, how is it displayed, how it should be stored, whatever, and you can reuse it for any content types. You can store the textual body of a content item the same way in pages, in blog posts, in widgets, in I don't know where. So this is the flexibility of content types. We will see even users are content items. So theoretically, you could attach the same body part to users. And then users would be able to, for example, write a short biography of themselves through this body editor. So it makes functionality very well reusable. So that's about content parts again. Sorry if you already understood everything, but I think it's important to rehearse it probably again, because it's very important. So we now see the widgets editor, but we have some foreign options here, like the zone and the layer and even the position. Well, title is something simple, so we don't bother with that. Name either. let's explore what zone and layer is. So let's go back to the widgets list, the widgets page. You can see we have a lot of boxes and everything here. Now what is that? First of all, we have a layer, this here. Now, what is a layer? A layer is practically nothing more than a container for widgets. So what we see here is the list of widgets that are on the default layer. More precisely, those widgets are on the default layer that are such greenish. So the main menu is on the default layer. The first leader aside, second leader aside, and third leader aside widgets are not on the default layer, but they are listed because this is a merged view of every widget in the system, every widget saved. So the only widget we have on the default layer is the main menu. And why this matters? Why do we have to have containers for widgets? Now, if you go to the front page, the menu widget is here. This is the menu widget, this is the menu, of course. And it should be displayed on every side. So if I go to the password change site, it should be still there, the menu. This is achieved with the default layer, because the default layer is set up in a way that it should be active on every pages. If you go to edit here, we will see the layers editor. As you can see, well, layers have a name, a description, and the layer rule. This layer rule is interesting because this is a logical expression. This is evaluated on every page load, and if it's true, then this layer will be active and every widget containing that layer will be displayed. So as you can see, this logical expression is quite simple here. I guess the outcome of this rule here will be true, probably. I'm not sure. But I think it will be true. So that means that this layer will be active for every page. That's why we see the menu on every page. Let's see something different. So these widgets are not greenish, though they don't belong to the default layer. If we go back to the editor, we see that this first leader aside's widgets layer is the home page. So let's see what the home page is about. Let's go back, let's select the home page. As you can see now, the main menu is gray, so it's not on this layer, and these triple widgets are greenish, so we are on the correct layer. And now let's see what the home page layer is about. Now its layer rule is a bit more complicated. We can use some expressions in these layer rules. It's a Ruby inspired syntax. It's something very simple. It has just a few features. One of them is this URL expression. So this will be true if this URL pattern here matches. Now, as you can see, it only matches if we are in the root, so on the home page. That means that, or that's the reason why these widgets are not displayed here. But we can turn it around, and we could say that the homepage layer, despite its name, should be only displayed on the change password page. So if we go here, and if we change this URL, and I save it, we should be able to see these widgets here. Yeah. So these widgets now appear here, and if we go to the homepage, they don't appear here. So we just changed how the layer is evaluated. But this is very bad to have the homepage layer match for the password modification side, so I will just set it back. You could add new layers anytime. There are some other default layers bundled in the default recipe. So for example, what we see here, this is not something defined in the code of Orchard. In the piece of software that defines how widgets and layers and everything works, nowhere is it defined how a default or an authenticated layer should look. This comes from the recipe. So remember when we installed Orchard, we have chosen the default recipe. Now this default recipe contains configuration for the layers too. So there, those layers are saved. And now that we have run the recipe, these layers are set up. The other examples are that the authenticated layer only matches for authenticated users. I think it's quite simple that it's called authenticated. Oops. There is also an anonymous layer, i.e. the not authenticated users. And as you can see, you can use the not keyword if you want to negate an expression. So basically these layers here are samples for every combination of these simple expressions you could use. Yeah, there is or also, so you could say, well, we could actually do that. We could make the homepage only match for authenticated users. And to do that, we should write that and authenticated. So and or you can use both. Yeah, respectively. I think this won't. Well, this works. All right. So if you go to the homepage now, nothing. Well, what is on the homepage? No, that's okay. And on the homepage, we should see the widgets, and it's not displaying. All right, I've made some mistake. And what's that? Well, it seems that despite I'm an admin and I'm logged in, I'm not authenticated, or I just made a spelling mistake. So the ultimate problem solving in programming, of course, is copy paste. So if you now go to authenticated and copy this, so I don't make a spelling mistake, and go back to the home page and say authenticated. And if it's still not working, then I will research why it's not working, because it should, and tell you on the course page. Probably it's a different syntax. Yeah, that's actually interesting, because if you fill in this expression, it should be validated. So if you make a mistake, a syntactical mistake like I have done here, yeah, it says it's not valid. Apparently I've made a mistake that wasn't validated, because I haven't used these parentheses here. This URL expression works that you can either use parentheses around the URL pattern or not. If you use this expression solely in one expression, you don't have to use parentheses. But if you use multiple URL expressions, you have to use parentheses. Now it looks like that even if you use it together with authenticated, you have to use parentheses. So yeah, this now works. Now one notion before we wrap up this lesson is zone. Now as you can see, we have a list here with header, navigation, featured, before main. These are zones. We have a small helper image here that I will just open separately so we can see. This is also a map of the zones, the layout of the zones we have in the theme. So as you can see, these zones are areas of the layout. So the header is naturally on the top, we have a navigation. The navigation is below the header, so this is the header here. Navigation should be this roughly. We have many zones, and for example, there are these triple first, triple second, triple third zones. So I think these should be these widgets, and if we go to the widgets editor, we can also check this. So let's go back again to our beloved first leader aside widget. And you can see that indeed it's in the triple third zone. container that will decide whether the widget is active for a current page, and you should put it in a zone that it that will decide where that widget will be put into the layout. So let's create a widget just quickly, and let's add it to the aside first zone. So if you go back to our little map, you can see that the aside first is on the left hand side of content. So if you put a widget there, it should appear somewhere here. So let's go here, select aside first, add, and let's create a new widget. As you can see, there are some widgets already in the system. These are content types, of course, as we have seen when I search for widget on the in the content type list. But really important is the menu widget. We already have one for a main menu, of course. You could take a look at home at its configuration. It's not something complicated. But at least we already have it defined for the main menu. But another quite important widget type is the is the HTML widget. So let's go back to the aside first and select HTML widget. Now the HTML widget is a simple widget that contains just a body. So as these triple widgets here. So let's give it a title like test widget and add some text. You see our zone is the aside first. We could choose the layer. Let it be default now. We could fill in the name. This name is just a technical name and it will be used as a class for the HTML element. So let's try that too. Let's call it test widget with a dash. And let's save it. If you go to the site and reload it, here we have our test widget. If we take a look at the HTML source code, well, it's quite complicated for Orchard actually, because there are many wrappers, many containers. By the way, you can see that Orchard puts this generator meta tag into the layout, that it tells us it's Orchard. And now if we search for test widget, we can see that here we have our widget, our widget's code. Actually, the widget itself is just this article here, and its class is widget test widget. So Orchard gives us many CSS classes in the markup that we can use to target elements. This is one option to the technical name that is also surfaced on the admin side. But we will take a look into all these in detail when we will learn about theme development. Widgets are that. You can create also widget content types from the dashboard, by the way. So just a quick glance at the HTML widgets content type definition again. If we go here, you can see that it also has a stereotype. Now the stereotype is kind of a category for content types. Widget means that this content type is a widget. This can be modified here. So you could just go on and create a new content type here, create new type, blah blah blah, and set the stereotype as widget, and you would be able to use that content type's items as widgets. This is the stereotype is really just a category. So the widgets module knows that it will only list content items here that have the stereotype widget. So that's it for widgets. And that's also enough for today. So what we have seen was the basic content management and site management configuration options and knowledge you have to just a quick overview. We haven't gone into real details yet, but this is the UI, so you can try it at home. Do try it at home, it's not dangerous. It's just a UI, so click through it and try what Orchard does. And next time we will take a look into other more complicated